चलो लेट्स स्टार्ट अहेड नेक्स्ट पार्ट. वेरी सिंपल सिंपल सेक्शंस आर गोइंग टू बी देयर इन द नेक्स्ट पार्ट. नाउ फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल सेक्शन नंबर 3 एंड सेक्शन नंबर 4. सेक्शन 3 एंड 4 टॉक्स अबाउट द पनिशमेंट फॉर द ऑफेंस ऑफ मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग. ओके फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल सेक्शन 3 वी हैव ऑलरेडी डन. सेक्शन 3 वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट द डेफिनेशन ऑफ मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग. रिमेंबर फर्स्ट द डेफिनेशन ऑफ मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग वाज गिवन इन 2(1)(p). देयर दे हैड रिटन दैट गो एंड रेफर सेक्शन नंबर 3. So that was nothing but your definition of money laundering. And now here in section number 4 we are going to have the punishment for the offense of money laundering. Okay, now this is very very simple as well as very very important. They have just divided the punishment into two parts. First one is what they are telling, that check whether the proceeds of crime involved in money laundering relate to any offense specified under para 2. Okay, para 2 of part A of the schedule. You remember in part A we had many paragraphs. First one was talking about IPC, next one was talking about drugs and so on and so forth, right? Now so here they are talking about the second paragraph, which is they are talking about the drugs, that is Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act 1985. So they are asking whether it involves, whether the proceeds of crime involved in the money laundering relate to that drugs offense. If it relates to drugs, if it relates to that drugs, then there is an imprisonment of minimum 3 years and maximum 10 years. So imprisonment, jail of 3 years to 7 years and fine, because they have written here fine also charged. Okay, but if it does not involve drugs, means it is any other offense, example it can be any other para of part A or it can be part B or part C, then we have imprisonment minimum 3 years and maximum of 7 years. Okay, here it is 3 years to 10 years, here it is 3 years to 7 years and fine. This is common in both. That is, in both the cases, we are going to have the fine thing applicable. Very clear with this? This is given in with section number, this is given in section 4 of your PML. Okay, chalo, next. Next one is your section number 5, which is going to come up main. Here they are talking about your attachment, adjudication and confiscation. Okay, attachment, adjudication and confiscation. Now attachment means, what are they telling? They are just putting a prohibition on us, they are just putting a restriction, they are just putting a restriction on us that we cannot transfer the property. Okay, transfer definition we had already seen there. We cannot transfer any particular property, we cannot convert into any other form, that is we cannot sell off our immovable property and convert into cash, we cannot give it to some other person, etc. You can just use it, but you cannot transfer it, that is called as your attachment. Okay. And this attachment, etc., the authority who is going to be involved here is your adjudicating authority. Adjudicating authority is a specific authority who is appointed under this PMLA just to do some particular acts. Okay, there's a particular level of authority who is being appointed. Okay, now check what is the next thing that they are telling in section number 5. Now we have our section number 5 starting from here. Section number 5 talks about attachment of property which is involved in money laundering. So first of all, it is such a property which is involved in the offense of money laundering, means this property would have earned, we would have earned this property out of proceeds of crime by doing any offense called as scheduled offense. Okay. So now here, first of all, at a basic level, there is an authority called as director. Okay, this director is basically a government official. Okay, it is a government official, government person named as your director. Okay, we have this particular level of authority where the director or any other officer not below the rank of deputy director, authorized by the director. So either it can be director or it can be any other officer, but at least of the level of deputy director and should be authorized by the director. Okay, now this director is a person who is an authority under this PMLA. This person has a reason to believe that yes, some property is involved in the offense of money laundering, or that person is involved in the offense of money laundering, or some proceeds of crime is being generated. Okay, so now if he has reasons to believe, and that should be in writing, then on that basis, if he is of the opinion that any person is in possession of proceeds of crime, means any person is having the proceeds of crime and he can transfer it to some other person, he can hide this proceeds of crime, because of which the process under PMLA may start, then in that case, this director or that any other officer can underline this. This is very, very important. Provisionally attach such property for a period not exceeding 180 days. That is, if the director or any other officer has reasons to believe that we are involved in this offense of money laundering and we can transfer it to some other person, we can hide it, we can conceal it, then it can do one thing, it can provisionally attach that particular property. Provisional attachment, if it is happening, that it can happen for a maximum period of 180 days from the date of the order. So whenever the director or the other officer passes the order from that day, within a, for a period of 180 days, it can be provisionally attached. Okay, chalo, let's revise till here. What did we do here in section number 5? Whether director or any other officer, if they have a reason to believe that yes, any person, if some person is holding this proceeds of crime, and then we can, if this person can transfer this proceeds of crime to some other person, or this person can deal in this proceeds of crime, then it can order for provision attachment, and which will be valid for a period of 180 days. Okay, now in that, what are they trying to say? Just try to understand this. Before doing this order of attachment, a report should be forwarded to the magistrate under section 173 of the Code of Criminal Procedure. Basically, we have to intimate to the magistrate about this, that we are going to do this provisional attachment, and the complaint has been filed by the person authorized to investigate the offense mentioned in that schedule before a magistrate for taking cognizance of that particular offense. Cognizance is nothing but taking note of the offense. That is, we have just forwarded, we have just filed a complaint with a magistrate that, sir, as per us, that person is, say for example, involved in the offense of IPC. So, sir, please investigate into the offense. Okay, or if the offense has been done outside India, then a similar report or complaint has been made or filed under that law of the other country. Say for example that murder, kidnapping, etc. has been done in US, then whatever law is prevailing in US, then a particular complaint has been filed under that particular law. This is basically a precondition for your provisional attachment. Okay, now for this prerequisite, they have given one exception. Okay, now what are they trying to tell here is, suppose if they had told, if you want to do provisional attachment, then first you have to go and submit this, you have to go and intimate to the magistrate, then you have to go and file a report with this magistrate, etc. But they are telling that if we do not have that much time with us to do all these activities, etc., or if suppose if you delay, then that person can abscond, that person can run away from India, that person can transfer, then what you can do is you can first do the provisional attachment and then you can go and submit this report with the magistrate. Understood what is happening? So by default, first you were supposed to go to the magistrate and then do the provisional attachment. But if you feel that we do not have this much time available, then first you can do provisional attachment and then you can go to the magistrate. Right? Okay, chalo, next. Next, one more proviso is given up here. Provided also that for the purpose of computing the period of 180 days during which the proceedings under the section is stayed by the High Court shall be excluded, and further period not exceeding 30 days from the date of order of vacation shall be counted. So what are they trying to tell us here is, say for example, provisional attachment order was passed on 1st Jan 2020. Okay, so provisional attachment will be valid for a period of 180 days. Okay, say for example, okay, I'm just taking an illustrative example. Say for example, 180 days period was getting over on 25th June 2020. Okay, this is just for example, I have not done the exact calculation. Suppose if it gets over on 25th June 2020, it was supposed to get over on this date, but in between we had got a High Court stay. Okay, from, say for example, from 1st March 2020 to 30th March 2020, we had got a High Court stay. During High Court stay, nothing could be done under PMLA Act. Therefore, what they are trying to say is, whatever period was wasted due to High Court stay, our due date will be extended by those many number of days. Okay, so say for example, after extension of 30 days, how did we get this 30 days? That is the stay period. Okay, the exact stay period, 30 days, will be extended here, and the new due date will be, say for example, 25th July 2020 will be the new date till which your provisional attachment is going to work. Okay, Now they are telling that because of stay, there are many paper formalities, etc., which are involved, and because of which some more time can be wasted. So we give you free extra 30 days. So now the new time duration will be 24th of August, by when your provisional attachment is going to get over. Okay. First we added 30 days. Why did we add 30 days? This was your stay period which was excluded. Okay, so that way, suppose here if the stay was of 15 days, then we would have added 15 days here. But after that, this 30 days is ad hoc, as it is 30 days is to be added. But these things are going to get applicable only if any stay is involved, if there is any stay which is involved. Very clear with this? Okay, suppose if there was no stay of the High Court, then your original due date will remain as it. Okay, that is given here. If you want to write down this example, you can just write it down. Chalo, I hope you are done till here. Yes, next. Next, check what are they talking about. They are telling that for doing all such things, who was the particular authority? The authority was your director or any other officer not below the rank of deputy director, and even that person should be authorized by the director. The same person, once he does the provisional attachment in the above point, he will forward a copy of the order along with his proof, that is the material in his possession, in a sealed envelope to a person called as your adjudicating authority in whatever is the manner prescribed, and such adjudicating authority shall keep such order and material for such period as may be prescribed. Okay, so initially the work was done by the director or the other officer. Then he submitted the report to the magistrate. Okay. Then after that, the director did the provisional attachment. We forwarded a report to the adjudicating authority. Okay. Now the matter now goes to the adjudicating authority, which we are going to refer in section number 8. Okay, so this third point is not to be referred here. This third point we can refer later on. Okay, so till now the matter goes just in the hands of the adjudicating authority. Till now the property is provisionally attached. The person cannot sell the property, but he is still enjoying the property. Okay, this person can still enjoy the property. Okay, then after that they are telling that when you submitted the report to the adjudicating authority, director has to do this thing, that is director to adjudicating authority, that report should go, this is important again, this should go within a period of 30 days from the date of attachment. That is director, when he was submitting it to the adjudicating authority, he has to do it within a period of 30 days from the date of attachment. Very clear till here? Yes? ओके चलो नाउ लेट्स रिवाइज फॉर आर नॉन साउथ इंडियन स्टूडेंट्स, लेट्स रिवाइज इट वन. ठीक है, सबसे पहले क्या किया, सबसे पहले डायरेक्टर आया या फिर पर्सन अदर देन डायरेक्टर एनी अदर ऑफिसर आया हु वॉज ऑथराइज बाय द डेप्यूटी डायरेक्टर. वो पर्सन आया, वो पर्सन आने के बाद में, वो पर्सन आने के बाद में उन्होंने रिपोर्ट दिया मैजिस्ट्रेट को, कंप्लेंट फाइल किया मैजिस्ट्रेट के सामने, उसके बाद में उन्होंने प्रोविजनल अटैचमेंट कर लिया. ठीक है, प्रोविजनल अटैचमेंट करने के बाद में उनको एए के पास में जाके, एडजुडिकेटिंग अथॉरिटी के पास में, दे हैड टू गो एंड सबमिट दिस रिपोर्ट. एए के पास में जाने का था कितने टाइम के अंदर, विद इन अ पीरियड ऑफ 30 डेज. 30 डेज कब से, 30 डेज फ्रॉम द डेट ऑफ अटैच. ओके चलो डन, नेक्स्ट लेट्स मूव अहेड. सेक्शन नंबर 6, this is a very procedural section, not very important, but we'll just complete it once. Now here they are talking about the adjudicating authority, how do we form this adjudicating authority, what are the powers of adjudicating authority, that we are going to do in this particular section. Okay, now first of all, adjudicating authority is appointed by the central government, all powers, duties, etc. is put by the central government. Okay, now adjudicating authority is not a single person. Okay, adjudicating authority is basically a group. Okay, it is a group which shall consist of chairperson and two other members. Okay, one, the head is the chairperson and is going to consider, it is going to include two other members, and one member each shall be a person having experience in the field of LAFA, LAFA. Okay, L stands for law, A stands for administration, F stands for finance, and A stands for administration. Each person should have the experience in these fields. Okay, now they have given the eligibility, that is the qualification. If he says that he is a member of the adjudicating authority, and if he says that I have the knowledge of law, then it will be treated as if he is having the knowledge of law only when he is qualified to be appointed as a district judge, or in the past he was a member of Indian Legal Service or has held the post in grade 1 of that service, or if he says that he's a person of finance or accountancy or administration, then he should have the prescribed qualification. Okay, so for law they have elaborated here, for others they are telling that he is having the prescribed qualification. Okay, these qualifications are to be held by the member of the adjudicating authority. Okay, the appointment etc. will be done by whom? The appointment etc. will be done by the central government. And here, how are they going to operate? Okay, now see, we know that in adjudicating authority, we have the chairperson. After the chairperson, we have at least two other members. Okay, so here we are going to do the work by forming of benches. Benches is, in our language, we can call it as a group. Okay, now the bench will be constituted. This group will be constituted by the chairperson. And in that bench, we are going to have one or two members. Means it can be a single member bench also, or it can be a dual member bench also, depending on the type of the case. And the bench normally sits at New Delhi, and it can sit at other places also, as the central government will tell us to do that. Fine. Now, cases can be transferred from one case, from one bench to another. Then even the members can be transferred from one bench to another. Right? Okay. Now, this eighth point is very, very important. The chairperson and every member shall hold office for a period of 5 years. Okay. Whoever comes in the office, his tenure will be for a period of 5 years and maximum up to 65 years of age. Whatever are the prescribed salary and allowances, that will be paid to that particular chairperson and members, and this will be prescribed by the central government. If there is any particular absence or if there is any vacancy in the place of this chairperson or other members, then they are telling that the vacancy shall be filled by the central government. Okay, there can be a vacancy, right? There can be a temporary vacancy also, there can be a permanent vacancy also. Temporary vacancy means any person is ill, he is not there, he is gone out of station, etc. Then after that, they are talking about resignation from office. These persons can resign from their office also. They'll have to submit their resignation to the central government. Why to the central government? Because they were appointed by the central government. So now even for resignation, we'll have to submit it to the central government. Okay. Now for that, they have to give a 3 months notice. Okay. They have basically given 3 periods there. And whichever is earlier will be the time period up to which they have to continue in the office. One is they have to give 3 months notice, or till his successor enters upon his office, or till the end of his tenure, whichever is earlier. okay, say for example there is no successor whom we are getting, or our tenure is going to get over very late, then at least for 3 months we have to be there in the office. Or if my successor enters upon the office in the next week itself, then you can vacate the office in the next week. So out of these three periods, whichever is earlier, you have to continue in the office mandatory. Okay, that was talking about your resignation. Now here they are talking about removal. Any person can be removed, but only if the order is passed by the central government. If any other authority says that you will be removed, no, you cannot be removed. You will be removed only if the order is passed by the central government. Okay, now then they are telling that suppose if there is any vacancy, okay, now there is any vacancy because of death, resignation, means they are talking about permanent vacancy in the place of chairperson. Okay, then they are telling that whoever is there as a senior most member, that person will act as the chairperson till a new chairperson is appointed. So senior most member is going to act in case of permanent vacancy. Okay, then they have to discharge their functions as told to them by the central government. So whatever central government or however central governments tell us to discharge, we have to do it. Okay, then they are regulated by the Code of Civil Procedure 1908. That is, they have all the powers as vested in a civil court. So they are regulated by this particular code. Right? So till here everything was very, very general. You need not by heart anything. Staff of the adjudicating authority, it will have whatever number of staff, whatever number of employees is needed to discharge the functions. Okay. See, till now we just had the chairperson. We had two minimum members in that. Right, but it's not that only three of them are going to do all the work of PMLA. So within that we are going to have some officers, we are going to have some employees, etc. Their appointment will be done by the central government, their salary, etc. will be determined by the central government. Right? Chalo. So done till here. Now the next section, a youth section coming up here, section number 8. Before we go ahead, if you want to just revise, you can just revise it once. The sections before section number 8, you can just revise it quickly. I'm giving you 2 minutes. Chalo, done, 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 done. We did the punishment, right, in section number 4. After that, we went to provision attachment, in which we studied about that 180 days. We studied about High Court. We studied about 330 days. Then we studied about giving the notice to the adjudicating authority. Then after that, we studied more about adjudicating authorities. See, section number 6 and 7 is not at all important. You can just put it as a one-time read before exam. Even if you don't read this, that's absolutely okay. Right? Chalo. Now let's go to the main section, section number 8, which talks about your adjudication. Okay, section 5 was talking about your attachment, where we did provisional attachment. Now we are talking about section number 8, which is talking about your adjudication. Right? Now, what are they telling us here is, in section number 8, you remember adjudicating authority had received a notice from the director. Yes, within a period of 30 days, it had received a notice. Now, if adjudicating authority has reasons to believe, See, someone has come to the adjudicating authority and complained. But directly the adjudicating authority won't act. Even adjudicating authority will try to find out the proofs, the reasons that any person has committed any offence under Section 3. Under Section 3 means the offence of money laundering and is in possession of proceeds of crime. Means that person has done any offence of money laundering plus that person is having the proceeds of crime. Then it will serve a notice of at least 30 days. Notice within 30 days? No, they are not talking about that. They are talking about service of notice of 30 days. Means the other person, the convicted person, accused person has to revert back within a period of 30 days on such person calling up upon him to indicate the sources of income, earnings or asset out of which or by means of which he has acquired the property which was attached under section number 5. Means we are just telling that particular person that just show us the sources. That is, out of which money did you purchase this asset? Okay, who is asking for the proof? The adjudicating authority. Adjudicating authority is asking about the proof. And basically, it is a show cause notice that why we should not declare your property to be involved in the property, to be involved in the offense of money laundering, and why we should not confiscate the property, why the central government should not confiscate this property. Okay, so who is issuing the show cause notice to whom? Adjudicating authority is issuing the show cause notice to the accused person that first thing is please show us the sources. From where did you purchase this asset? From which money did you purchase this asset? And second, why? Just your like your show cause notice, why we should not confiscate, why we should not declare this as involved in money laundering. Okay, and the other person's accused person has to revert back within a period of 30 days. Okay, whenever the notice is served on this accused person, from that day he has to revert back within a period of 30 days. Okay, now listen, if suppose this accused person is a joint holder of the property, means the property is held by two persons, by A and by B, then the notice will be served on both of them. Okay, in case of joint holding, the notice will be served on both of them. Okay, now what is going to happen after that? After this, can I say the accused person is going to revert back? Okay, what can be the possible replies? First of all, he will reply within a period of 30 days. Okay, he replies within a period of 30 days. And the reply is a satisfactory reply. Reply is a satisfactory reply means yes, he has given proper reply and it shows that the property is not involved in the offense of money laundering. Then in that case, if suppose originally provisional attachment was done under section 5, then that provisional attachment will now get vacated. Means no provisional attachment will be valid now. Okay, acha. Suppose if he does not reply at all, no reply is received, then we are going to proceed ahead and we are going to do something called as adjudication. Okay, we are going to do something called as adjudication, means we are going to proceed ahead and we are going to convict that particular person and we are going to now treat that person as an accused person. Right? So check what are they writing here. Considering the reply, we are going to hear the aggrieved person. We are going to take all the proof that he has submitted to us. And then we are going to decide whether it is involved in money laundering or it is not involved in the offense of money laundering. Basically, we are going to give him something called as reasonable opportunity of being heard, because that is very, very mandatory. Very clear with this? Yes. Now, check the next one. This is very, very important. Where the adjudicating authority decides that any property is involved, means this case, where he feels that yes, the reply is not proper, okay, where he replies within 30 days, but the reply is not at all proper, means he has replied, but the reply is not at all satisfactory, then in that case, adjudicating authority by an order in writing, he will confirm the attachment. He will say that yes, now your property actually gets attached. We are not talking about provisional attachment. Now the property actually is getting attached. ओके, और इफ इनिशियली प्रोविजनल अटैचमेंट वॉज डन, नाउ इट विल बी कन्वर्टेड इंटू फाइनल अटैचमेंट. इफ नो प्रोविजनल अटैचमेंट वॉज डन, देन इट विल बी डिरेक्टली पुट इंटू अटैचमेंट. ओके, नाउ अटैचमेंट वॉज डन एंड दिस विल कंटिन्यू, दिस अटैचमेंट विल कंटिन्यू ड्यूरिंग इन्वेस्टिगेशन फॉर अ पीरियड नॉट एक्सीडिंग 365 डेज और पेंडेंसी ऑफ प्रोसीडिंग बिफोर अ कोर्ट और करस्पॉन्डिंग लॉ ऑफ एनी अदर कंट्री बिफोर द कॉम्पिटेंट कोर्ट ऑफ क्रिमिनल ज्यूरिस्डिक्शन आउटसाइड इंडिया. मीन्स नाउ जस्ट ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड वॉट इज हैपनिंग योर. फर्स्ट योर प्रोविजनल अटैचमेंट वॉज डन बाई द डिरेक्टर, ओके, और एनी अदर ऑफिसर. आफ्टर दिस देयर कम समथिंग कॉल्ड एज अटैचमेंट. दिस अटैचमेंट वॉज कन्फर्म्ड बाय द एडजुडिकेटिंग अथॉरिटी. एडजुडिकेटिंग अथॉरिटी सेज दैट येस नाउ द अटैचमेंट हैज बीन कन्फर्म्ड, ओके, एंड नाउ आफ्टर दैट वंस दिस इज डन आफ्टर दैट अटैचमेंट, ओके, दिस प्रोविजनल अटैचमेंट वॉज गोइंग ऑन फॉर अ पीरियड ऑफ 180 डेज, राइट. अटैचमेंट इज गोइंग टू गो ऑन फॉर अ पीरियड ऑफ 365 डेज till the time some more investigation will be done by the court. Okay, till now director was doing his work, AA was doing his work, now the courts are going to do the investigation, and during the investigation also the attachment is going to continue for a period of 365 days. Okay, earlier we had a period of 90 days here, but then it was amended to 365 days, right. And the conclusion of this, okay, within this period of 365 days, basically an order of special court must be passed, which is going to say that yes, the property now stands confiscated or the property now stands released. That is, if the person is found guilty, then it will be confiscated. If the person is not found guilty, then the property will be released. Basically, there is an interpretation that this has to be completed within a period of 365 days. Right? Acha. Now, it can so happen that during this period of 365 days, we have got a stay. Then, whatever period of stay was there, say for example, there was a stay of 2 months. Then in this 365 days, this 2 months will be added. Okay, legally they use the word this period will be excluded, which means that we will get more time of 2 months. But here we are not going to get any free period like we got when we were doing section number 5. Very clear with this? Yes, that is written here in the block. Okay, after that, suppose if confiscation order is passed, then the property will be confiscated. If released order is passed, then the property will be released. Okay, that is given here. If the property gets confiscated, it will now go to the central government, as you already know. Yes? Acha. Now, what are they trying to tell? Just try to understand the sixth point. Okay? Where on conclusion of a trial under this act, means once the investigation by the special court etc. is completed and the special court finds that the offense of money laundering has not at all taken place, or the property is not involved in money laundering, it shall release it. So if that person is not found guilty, then it will be totally released. Okay, then again the seventh point, eighth point etc. is important. Check what are they trying to tell us here in the seventh point. Where the trial under this act cannot be conducted by reason of death of the accused person, or the accused person has been declared as a proclaimed offender, or for any other reason, the special court shall, on an application moved by the director, pass appropriate orders regarding confiscation or release, as the case may be, involved in the offense of money laundering, as after having regard to the material before. Okay, suppose if that person has passed away, if that accused person has passed away, etc., or that person has been declared as a, you know, proclaimed offender, that yes, he does offenses many times, then in that case, a particular special order will be passed against that particular person, and we are going to either confiscate the property or we are going to release the property. Yes. Now here we are going to study something different. Check what are they telling here in this point number 8, where the property stands confiscated to the central government. Okay, the special court will direct, it may direct to the central government to restore such confiscated property or part thereof of a claimant with some legal interest in the property who may have suffered some amount of losses as a result of offense of money laundering. Okay, now say for example, after confiscation we come to know, for example, that there are joint holders in the property. Joint owners are there, and one such owner is there who says that no sir, I was not guilty, and he proves that he was not at all guilty. Then we can compensate him, we can give his share in the property. Okay, that is given here. Provided that the special court shall not consider such claim until unless the claimant has acted in good faith. Yes, he will get the compensation only if he has acted in good faith. Very clear till here? Till here, whatever we studied was coming in your section number 8. Let's revise this section number 8 quickly. What happened in section number 8 was, we basically saw the powers of the adjudicating authority. Once the complaint was taken by the adjudicating authority gave a show cause notice to that particular accused person to give two things. First is the sources, that from where did you purchase this asset, and it gave a show cause notice that why we should not declare the property as proceeds of crime and why we should not declare you as a person involved in the offense of money laundering, and that person has to reply within a period of 30 days. Okay, that person has to reply within a period of 30 days from the date of the order. If the property is held by multiple persons, then we are going to issue the notice on the joint holders. Acha. Now, once we receive the reply, if the reply is satisfactory, then we will release the property. If the reply is not at all satisfactory, then we are going to confiscate it. Right? Or if no reply is received, then also we are going to confiscate it. In case of confiscation, we are going to do something called as attachment. Okay, attachment will be valid for a period of 365 days, and during this period of 365 days, the special court is going to do the investigation and will again, it is going to find out whether the person is found guilty or the person is not guilty. Okay, if the person is found guilty, then the property gets confiscated by the central government and it will now vest with the central government. If the person is not found guilty, then we are going to release that particular asset. Okay, and one more thing, please remember this point which is going to come up I think next, that is in section number 9, vesting of property in central government. Once the property goes in the hands of central government, just remember one thing, only the property or only the asset goes to the central government and not the underlying liability. The underlying liability does not go to the central government. Example, if suppose central government has attached our plant and machinery, but our plant and machinery was given as mortgage with the bank, okay, against any bank loan, etc., then bank loan is still our responsibility. Central government won't pay. Central government will simply take the assets. Okay, that is given here in section number 9. Very clear till here? Yes. Okay, for my north, west, east students, new. Okay, for my non-South Indian students, let's revise this section number 8 once. What happened in section number 8? Section number 8 mein ek baar jab A ke hath mein case aa gaya, to A ne kya kiya? A ne ek show cause notice issue kiya wo person ke upar ki bhai bata ki hum tere property ko involved in money laundering treat kyun na kare, dusra sources bata ki tune ye asset kahan se purchase kiya tha. Samne wale person ko reply karna padega within a period of 30 days. Agar usne reply kar diya, acha reply kiya, to best hai, release ho jayegi property. Agar usne reply kiya lekin nonsense reply tha, non satisfactory reply tha, तो हम उसको अभी अटैच कर लेंगे, अटैचमेंट वैलिड हो जाएगा, अटैचमेंट बोल के हम उसको डिक्लेयर कर देंगे, या फिर अगर रिप्लाई नहीं भी आता तो भी हम उसको अटैच कर लेंगे. ठीक है, एक बार अगर अटैच कर लिया हमने उसको, उसके बाद में ये जो अटैचमेंट रहेगा दैट विल बी वैलिड फॉर अ पीरियड ऑफ 365 डेज. 365 डेज के अंदर अगर कभी बीच में स्टे आ गया तो जितना भी स्टे का पीरियड रहेगा उतना अपन को और मिल जाएगा, लेकिन उसके अलावा कुछ और एक्स्ट्रा पीरियड नहीं मिलने वाला. ठीक है, ये होने के बाद में आपके स्पेशल कोर्ट का ऑर्डर आ जाएगा. स्पेशल कोर्ट उसको या तो रिलीज कर देगी या तो उसको अटैच कर लेगी. ठीक है, स्पेशल कोर्ट ने एक बार अगर ट्रीट कर लिया कि नहीं भाई गिल्टी तो है, तो उसके बाद में प्रॉपर्टी गेट्स कॉन्फिस्केटेड. कॉन्फिस्केट होने के बाद में प्रॉपर्टी किसके हाथ में चली जाएगी? इट विल गो इन द हैंड्स ऑफ द सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट. सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट के पास में सिर्फ एसेट जाएगा, उसका अंडरलाइंग लाइबिलिटी नहीं जाएगा. वेरी क्लियर टिल योर? यस. चलो, सो टिल योर वी आर डन विथ वन इम्पॉर्टेंट पार्ट ऑफ द चैप्टर बेसिकली. So just revise till here and then we are going to continue ahead.